At the time I came into his possession, Edwin Epps was fond of the bottle, his sprees sometimes extending over the space of 2 whole weeks. When in his cups, Master Epps was a roistering, blustering, noisy fellow, whose chief delight was in dancing with his niggers or lashing them about the yard with his long whip, just for the pleasure of hearing them screech and scream as the great welts were planted on their backs.
Damn all y'all!
It's that godless lot. They brought this on me. I bring them God's word, and heathens they are, they brought me God's scorn.
Michael is an extraordinary actor. And in this, he created something so full, so rounded. It's a personality. He is somebody who believes that he is living virtuously.
They ain't hired help. They're my property.
You say that with pride.
I say it as fact.
And it is that belief structure that is so impossible to break. That is why these two men clash so completely.
Well, you won't stand idle, boy. Not on my land.
It's an immediate disliking because Epps feels inadequate around Solomon, funnily enough. And that's very much at the root of their relationship. Solomon just has to sort of follow orders, basically. And it's a dancing game.
You come here. Master Epps.
Master, come here!
There's no one else who could play that role, really. I mean, he's extraordinary. I mean, often in this case, I'd be approaching him for something, and he'll say, yeah, I know. And you know, he'll do exactly what I was thinking. But also, there's a situation where we can actually be direct and honest, and there's a direct communication of how we want things to be done. He's not loose, he's a total professional. Everything you see on screen is because he worked for it.
It's the Lord's Day. And you know, if a Christian and us carry on like this.
Steve works fast, and it's demanding, you know what I mean? The days are full.
Woo!
Where's your merriment? Move your feet!
But we're kind of used to each other in terms of sort of dialogue and how we sort of communicate, and I think what we're looking for, we seem to be on the same wavelength.
Damn queen. Born, bred to the field.
Patsy was slim and straight. She stood erect as the human form is capable of standing. There was an air of loftiness in her movement that neither labor nor weariness nor punishment could destroy. Truly, Patsy was a splendid animal. And were it not that bondage had enshrouded her intellect in utter and everlasting darkness, would have been chief among 10,000 of her people.
I ain't got no comfort in this life.
Lupita, who plays Patsy, is just an amazing actress.
If I can't buy mercy from you, I'll beg it.
We auditioned over 1,000 women for that role, and then she just shone through.
I know what it's like to be the object of masses' predilections and peculiarities.
It's like watching a discovery of a new celestial entity. She's very present, very open, unaffected in her approach to the work.
That's my girl. Don't ever let me down.
I mean, it was a dream come true to get to work with Michael on my first film. He's a real sweetheart, but he also He brings it, and you feel it. What gets captured on camera is what is actually happening in the scene. So he's terrifying, but he's also really a gentle person in real life, which made it safe to do the things I had to do with him.
Sell her.
I will not.
You will remove that black bitch from his property, or I'll take myself back to Janieville.
Well, there's a kind of odd triangle there with Mrs. Epps, Mr. Epps, and Patsy. You know, Epps, I think, is in love, madly in love, but he doesn't understand how he can have feelings for a slave. And there's a guilt element to it, and there's a repulsive element to himself about it.
So much of the story is told in the book from Solomon's point of view, and there are many things about my relationship to my husband he could not have known about. So we kind of had to fill in some of the blanks. But I think, and something that we had decided, is that she loves him, and I think she's supremely jealous. And it's not just because it's a slave that he's in love with, but it's that he has any eyes for any other woman is incredibly hurtful to her.
You can't remain the Sabbath without her under your eye.
Hold on.
You are a no-account bastard, a filthy, godless heathen. My bed is too holy for you to share.
Sarah was just so powerful because she wasn't afraid. I mean, on paper, it's a hard role to do, and I think, you know, a lot of people like the idea of doing it, but when they do it, they can't actually do it because they bring in their own selves into the role. Well, there was one line that I was always testing people if they could live it correctly. And she was the only one who could live that line.
Same as the rest, Master brought you here to work, that's all. Any more, I'll earn you 100 lashes.
It was like poetry from her tongue, in a way that it wasn't the most beautiful thing to hear, but it came naturally. And she was amazing.
You want that? You want them black animals leave us gut like pigs in our own sleep?
It was very clear to me that there was no way for me to try to soften her or to make her anything other than what she was, and that the story couldn't be told properly unless I really went there.
Beat it from her!
It wasn't about finding some piece of me that could connect to her, because there isn't any part of me that can understand the way she behaved, but I had to just try to get into the mindset of a person who believed these things.
I said eat.
You're doing this to yourself, Pats.
Stepping to the piazza, he took down a heavy whip and, placing it in my hands, commanded me to lash her. Unpleasant as it was, I was compelled to obey him. Nowhere that day, on the face of the whole earth, I venture to say, was there such a demoniac exhibition witnessed as then ensued.
Beat her. Give her the whip, give it all to her.
The beatings are part of the narrative. So you couldn't make this film, for me, in my mind, without it being an integral part of the narrative. So it's not about exploiting or trying to shock, not interested. It's about showing what happened.
That was one of the more harrowing days on set. I mean, I remember being in the makeup trailer with Lupita, and she had to get naked. She had to be tied to a pole and whipped mercilessly, with Michael and I standing there, me standing there quite pleased. And those kinds of things are, from an acting standpoint, incredibly difficult to do.
He pantomimes. There's barely a welt on him.
It's always the same sort of process. I just sort of go over the scenes a lot, try and find what parts in the story are trying to sort of reveal certain aspects of the character. What he's sort of searching for himself, where is it coming from? Is there a route, you know, to this sort of violence? Deal with them logically, as opposed to an emotional sort of standpoint.
You will strike her until her flesh is rent, and meat and blood flow equal. I will kill every nigger in my sight. You understand me? Strike her! Strike her!
Steve had set out that he was going to do the moment where Solomon is forced to whip Patsy as an all-in-one shot, and that was always on the table right from the beginning. By that I mean there's no cuts, it's just continuous action from the beginning of the scene to the end of the scene. And that Sean Bobbitt follows the many characters, Patsy, Solomon, Mr. Epps, Mistress Epps, and takes them all into the kind of mix.
It goes on for what it takes. There's nothing wasted, it's lean, it's a very lean scene. Nothing is there without a reason.
Till I say no more, I ain't said nothing.
It's a whirlwind. It starts off slow, and it gets faster and faster until you're in the eye of the storm. And that's what we're building up to. That's why we're whirling around, that's why the camera's constantly moving. We have to build up to it.
Get me away! Get
up! The idea is that the camera is simply responding to the performance the whole time. And as such, the audience then feel a part of that performance.
In the course of eternal justice, thou shalt answer for this sin. Sin. There is no sin. Man does how he pleases with his property.
The lash was wet with blood, which flowed down her sides and dropped upon the ground. At length, she ceased struggling. Her head sank listlessly on the ground. Her screams and supplications gradually decreased and died away into a low moan. She no longer writhed and shrank beneath the lash when it bit out small pieces of her flesh. I thought that she was dying.
On several of the characters, especially the character Patsy, they had to be fresh scars on top of old scars, because this character was a slave from when she was very young. So various layers of scars, and then finally the fresh scars on top. And these are done from molds. They're carved and then poured and then placed. And they were literally placed layer on top of layers to make it look thick for Patsy.
This conversation concerns what is factual and what is not. Then it must be said that there is no justice nor righteousness in this slavery.
Well, to be honest, without Brad Pitt, this film wouldn't be made. That's just a fact. I mean, it's not an if or but or maybe. I just feel without Brad Pitt, this film would not have been made. And his contribution as a producer is full on in the way that he is direct, always helpful, and just very supportive to the filmmaker. And as an actor, I mean, you know, in the most smallest roles you see, I mean, you know, he's definitely a movie star because you put him in that, and it's like, oh, okay. He does more to it than, you know, most people would. So he is pretty unique.
I will write your letter, sir. And if it brings you your freedom, it will be more than a pleasure. It will have been my duty.
Chiwetel really sort of conjures up the most profound empathy. I mean, not just because of the situation. There's something about him and what he transmits as an actor that's just very earnest, very vulnerable, very sharp, humorous, but just something that you really care for him. You really, really care for him.
On your life, you answer me truthfully. Have you any other name than Platt?
Solomon Northup is my name.
And he does it so gently. He's so gentle.
You can't imagine how difficult it was to do what he had to do. First of all, he's in every scene. And then to physically have to endure the life of a slave for 15 hours a day, it's a rigorous workout.
And action.
I mean, towards the end, he was somewhere else, and he was very much in depth in Solomon. And that was impressive and pretty amazing to see. I mean, it takes a lot of courage, and it takes a lot of strength to keep in within that character. So that period of time is exhausting, basically.
When the violence of our emotions had subsided to a sacred joy, when the household gathered round the fire that sent out its warm and crackling comfort through the room, we conversed of the thousand events that had occurred, the hopes and fears, the joys and sorrows, the trials and troubles we had each experienced during the long separation. Well, Steve was a rock, you know. Steve was a rock every day of shooting this film. Constantly checking in, constantly supportive. We were constantly talking about different beats, different things, you know. And then when we got any time off, we'd go out and laugh and hang out. And he was very aware of what it would take to play Solomon Northup. And so he was always right there, you know, ready to sort of take on any challenges that I was feeling, which is exactly what it needed, was what it requires, you know, as a director who is completely aware of what you're going through and what sometimes what he's asking you to do, but totally prepared to stick by what he's asking you to do.
That's great. We took the gate on that. That's marvelous. Wonderful. At the doorway.
He has such faith in the narrative and the characters and in human behavior, and such faith in the fireworks that just come out of real life that he doesn't feel the need to add trickery to it.
You know, Steve's just very good with human beings, I think, and understands human behavior and has a curiosity in it for sure, and approaches it in a non-judgmental way and knows how to motivate people, and he's passionate about what he's doing and he expects that from everyone else. He's just a very inspirational person to be around. I realized that the first time I met him. I knew that I'd learn from him.
This is no fiction, no exaggeration. If I have failed in anything, it has been in presenting to the reader too prominently the bright side of the picture.
Interestingly, slavery historians who are interested in understanding the actual material circumstances of slavery often reference 12 Years a Slave in academic texts, but he's not known to the public. And one of the things that would be a wonderful outcome of the film would be if the book would be rediscovered by the public.
I survive! I will not fall into despair. I will offer up my talents to Master Ford. I will keep myself hardy till freedom is opportune.
I think Solomon Northup's legacy is that he was a survivor. He kept his spirits up as much as he could. He used his music, playing the fiddle, and he always had in the back of his mind, somehow he would find a way to get free.
Steve McQueen's 12 Years a Slave is the greatest realistic depiction of slavery. He makes you breathe it, smell it, feel it, suffer under the burden of slavery. That's the strength of the film.
It was a horrible, horrible thing. But you realize what my ancestors did to build this nation, the things that are unsaid and unread. It breaks my heart, but it also gives me a sense of pride because we own this American dream as much as anyone else.
Mama!
And we should be mindful of that.
If justice had been done, I never would have been here.
I think that the book is a testament to Solomon Northup, but also about a testament to the history of what was going on within slavery at that time. And it's a part of the history of America, which of course is no longer here, and which the country has overcome in great and incredible ways.
Laws change, Epps. Universal truths are constant. It is a fact that what is true and right for all.
My biggest ambition of the film is that it can reach as many people as possible, black, white, Hispanic, Asian, whatever, within America, because it is an American story. You know, first and foremost, it's an American story.
Chastened and subdued in spirit by the sufferings I have borne, and thankful to that good being through whose mercy I have been restored to happiness and liberty, I hope henceforward to lead an upright, though lowly life, and rest at last in the churchyard where my father sleeps.